20th century cosmology, fact or myth. The subject of scientific cosmology may be said to have evolved from the Enlightenment of the High Renaissance, notably in the work of Copernicus, Galileo, Bray, Kepler, and Newton. This work has been described vividly by the novelist Arthur Koestler in his 1960s book, The Sleepwalkers. Lord Clark has analysed the nature of civilization in his book and BBC series of that name, also a 60s production, now on Google Videos. Civilization is very fragile and depends on intellectual honesty. There are intervals in the human condition where youthful innocence of thought is brought vividly to enlightenment, other intervals of time when civilization almost destroys itself through aged cynicism, apathy, and decadence. This cycle of events has also been analyzed by Gibbon in his Rise and Fall of the Roman Empire. Around the year 1600, both forces were at play. Shakespeare, the agnostic, was in his prime. Bacon was about to formulate his philosophy of science, but Bruno was burnt by dogmatists for his scientific views. Around that year, Johannes Kepler, imperial mathematicus at Prague, began the task of analysing the data of the astronomer Tycho Brahe for the orbit of Mars. The prevalent dogma was that orbits must be circles. Any observed deviation from circles or spheres in three dimensions must be due to other circles, the dogma of epicycles. This dogma had been prevalent since the time of the Greeks, notably in the work of Aristotle. The Baconian view of science, based to an extent on Plato, is the opposite to the Aristotelian. Bacon argues that science must be based on observation. The Aristotelian view, taken up by the greatest of European powers of the time, the Church, was that nature is governed by dogma, or what would have been known as the divine spheres. So orbits must be circles. If orbits were observed not to be circles, then they must still be circles. That was still the attitude of the 20th century, as we shall shortly learn. Within a few years, Kepler had produced three laws of planetary motion that blew away the cobwebs of dogma. The inference of these laws required great effort and calculations that had to be done by hand. Tycho Brahe was wholly uncooperative, and Galileo Galilei shunned and minimized Kepler as a rival, giving him no encouragement at all. The orbit of Mars proved to be an ellipse, and one of Kepler's laws is that all orbits are ellipses. This is one of the first clear examples of scientific cosmology. Kepler was able to go against dogma and get away with it because of enlightenment in Prague at the court of the Holy Roman Emperor. Kepler was a Protestant but became the imperial mathematicus of Prague because of ability. Another sign of enlightenment. Luckily, he did not share the fate of Bruno, burnt at the stake in 1600 in Geneva by Calvinist dogmatists, or Galileo, who was impeached by Catholic dogmatists. It took until our times for Galileo to be pardoned for the offence of scientific truth. The explanation of Kepler's three laws in terms of universal gravitation is attributed to Isaac Newton in about 1665 at Woolsthorpe Manor when Cambridge was closed by plague. Newton appears to have realized intuitively that the three planetary laws of Kepler can be explained by what is known in contemporary times as universal gravitation. In classical dynamics of our era, there is a force between two masses which diminishes in proportion to the inverse of the square of the distance between them. This is not the language used by Newton, however, in 1665. It took until 1687 for him to find the mathematical methods needed to prove that an inverse square law results in an elliptical orbit. These are the methods of, that Newton called fluxions, now known as differentiation and integration. Even then, it is not clear from his famous book, The Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, that Newton ever proved the aforestated Kepler laws himself. The book is written in Latin and does not use modern algebra at all. However, Newton's work was another clear step towards scientific cosmology, because a lot of things could be explained using one idea, universal gravitation. The idea of force is attributed by Kepler to Kepler, not to Newton, and Kepler's book is full of careful scholarship using source documents. Gradually, the important ideas of Newton were extended, notably by Euler, Lagrange, Coriolis, and Hamilton, and many others, made simpler and easier to understand, and new general principles developed. The masterpiece of this type of cosmology is Laplace, celestial mechanics. Relativity changed all that in the late 1880s, following an experiment based on interferometry by Michelson and Morley in Case Western Reserve University. This experiment showed that the speed of light, c, does not change in different reference frames. This result required radical, counter-dogmatic, and counter-intuitive thought to explain it, although the constancy of C was already implicit in the earlier work of Maxwell and Heaviside in electrodynamics. The latter were known not to obey Newtonian principles. The subject of relativity seems to have been brought into being by Oliver Heaviside himself, in correspondence with George Francis Fitzgerald. The former was an outsider to the academic world, but among those in the know, highly respected. The latter worked at Trinity College Dublin, where the influence of William Rowan Hamilton was overwhelming. They appeared to have edged towards the idea that length and time were not absolute. This idea was brought into mathematical form by Voigt and Lorentz and several others in the late 19th century, culminating in the concept of space-time. This is a four-dimensional entity in which time multiplied by c is one coordinate. The incorporation of time as a coordinate means that equations of motion can be obtained from space-time, and that a Hamiltonian can be defined from space-time. This is profoundly different from Newton's idea of space. Einstein's contribution to relativity has been reassessed by recent scholarship. His contribution to special relativity in 1905 was essentially to apply the ideas of electrodynamics to dynamics, notably that the speed of light in a vacuum, c, must also be constant in dynamics. The transformation was already inherent in electrodynamics, and the then new tensor algebra was developed by Lorentz, Poincaré and several others to prove it. Einstein had a fluent grasp of Italian and read a paper in that language in which the famous idea of rest mass E equals mc squared was proposed. One of Einstein's important contributions was to prove this from the definition of relativistic momentum, p equals gamma mv, where gamma is the factor of the Lorentz transform. The rest energy and energy equation both follow from this definition. So, many scientists contributed to relativity, and there is more than one way of interpreting the special relativistic equations of Einstein. Horst Eckhardt, for example, has given a new interpretation on www.ais.us and published it recently. Recent scholarship has shown beyond reasonable doubt that Einstein's contributions to general relativity were important, otherwise we would not still be talking about him, but deeply flawed. The Einstein Cartan Evans theory is accepted as the one that most successfully mends the flaws in Einstein's mathematics. 20th century cosmology was was fiction because it was based on a field equation of 1916, produced independently by Einstein and Hilbert. By now it is very easy to show, given an open mind, that this field equation is geometrically incorrect. There have been doubts about this equation since about 1918, when Schrödinger and Bauer found flaws in it, but due to apathy and dogma, the enemies of civilization, these valid criticisms have been ignored. Recently, in UFT 150 on www.ais.us, it has been shown that Einstein's calculation of light deflection by gravitation is incorrect. In the field equation, Einstein used the wrong symmetry for the geometrical connection, and in his light deflection calculation, he made a complete mess of working out an integral. It follows that 20th century cosmology was mythology, as is being realized very quickly now. Observations show that there was no Big Bang. Observations show that dark matter theory is wrong. The theory behind black holes is wrong. It should not surprise us in the least that these ideas are kept alive by a dogmatic academia that plays the role of dogmatic theology in earlier times. The same motives are still there, adherence to party lines, one way of summarizing them. In other words, cynical adherence to a power that in reality does not survive for very long. Cynicism becomes old and bitter and is not tolerated by a youthful era of civilization, by an enlightenment of new and spontaneous thought. So ECE theory has cleared the way for an entirely new era in scientific cosmology. Even the academic system itself has been swept away by a spontaneous flowering of new ideas, a flowering caused by enlightenment. Burning at the stake has gone out of fashion and has been replaced by the less deadly game of cyber-stalking. Human nature has not changed, and there is always a light side and always a dark side. Sometimes the coin falls briefly but vividly on the light side, and this is what we are seeing now. Academia controls the jobs, money, power and prizes, but for no purpose. Similarly, empty theological dogma degenerated into the horrors of a 30 years war, during which all kinds of cruelty were inflicted by dogmatists in the name of religion. Even by the standards of the 20th century, these cruelties were remarkable. It may well be that we will go to war over light deflection due to gravitation, but sane individuals have more important things to do, notably to survive. This means finding new sources of energy, and here again, ECE theory seems promising. A system of free thought has come into being spontaneously and has replaced academic dogma. One cannot stop people thinking for themselves. One cannot stop the march of ideas, as Victor Hugo thought.